So talk about timely topics that were put together for Lanphear Live. We had major hacks before and after James Luda's talk about cybersecurity and disinformation. Our hurricane expert, the whole lecture was canceled because we had a hurricane. When was the last hurricane to hit land at Westerly, Rhode Island? I think that we're going to learn tonight. The last week has been a pretty hectic week for our speaker, David Vallee. As Hurricane Henri made landfall in Westerly, David's team at the National Weather Service Northeast River Forecast Center in Taunton was busy running their models, their hydrologic models, to determine which rivers might crest and what communities might be at risk from flooding. The monster storm that we're following now, Hurricane Ida, is now winding its way to the Northeast. And I'm guessing that David Vallee's team is doing a little bit of modeling to see what the impacts of that might be to our region. Dave is the hydrologist in charge at the Taunton Lab. They do forecasting of extreme weather, floods, but also droughts. The work that David and his team do save lives and save property throughout the northeastern U.S. Weather writ large is Dave's profession, but his true love, his true passion, hurricanes. And we're going to hear about that tonight. He's appeared in documentaries produced by the Weather Channel, the Discovery Channel. He's a recipient of the Isaac Klein Award for Leadership. This is the highest honor the National Weather Service bestows on individuals who have advanced the science of weather forecasting. As I think that we'll see tonight too, David Vallee is a lifelong Rhode Islander. His very first job as an intern, weather intern at TF Green Airport. We're very fortunate to have David Vallee speak with us this evening. Please join me in giving David a very warm welcome.
All right, no pressure. So I've learned in my life, God has a funny sense of humor. Being preempted by a hurricane talk, being preempted by a hurricane was quite comical. My wife and I were actually vacationing in Vermont, and my phone was ringing off the hook the entire time we were there, to her dismay, partly to mine. Matt Allen's calling me to get me on the radio at 2 o'clock as I'm coming off the Lake Champlain Ethan Allen cruise. It was one of those weekends. Tonight, I have to do my government service because I am a federal servant. Thank you for paying for my salary. But I'm going to give a lot of that back to you tonight, I promise. So, there's been a theme the last 20 years. And it's very disturbing to me personally. We used to see Category 4 monsters hitting the Gulf Coast maybe once a decade. We're seeing them hit every 1 or 2 years. That's a problem. Our biggest challenge here in New England is very simply our inexperience. Gulf Coast, very experienced. More so than any of those residents would like to admit. But for us, you have to go back 67 years. We are on the eve of the last Category 3 hurricane to have struck this state of ours. Carol, my mom's generation. She was a teenager in 1954, working a cash register in the old Shepherd's department store, making her way to Rhode Island College to become an educator. And in fact, at 85, she just decided to hang them up. God bless her, as an elementary educator. She had to swim out of the Shepherd's department store on the morning of August 31st, 1954. Okay, that was pre-barrier, pre-satellite imagery, pre-forecast models, pre-a lot of things, pre-me. So I'm only 54. And therein lies the problem, ladies and gentlemen. I'm 54. I haven't lived through a Cat 3 hurricane. I've lived through Gloria, Category 1, low tide, big whoop. Really, low tide, big whoop. I lived through Bob. Nice, but it missed us. Yes, the eye went over Newport. And yes, it laid down a whole lot of lumber in, on Aquidneck Island. But the core of that wind field went over Martha's Vineyard. Didn't maximize the potential. Let's see, Floyd, 1999, big rainstorm. Irene, big rains. Well, we had tons of power outages. By deaths from 1,000 microbursts, right? We had all this crazy wind blowing through this place. With every line of thunderstorms that rolled through as the circulation made its way up into Vermont, flooding the bejesus out of people. That wasn't a Cat 3. Sandy wasn't even a hurricane by definition on this very shoreline. And look at the mess it made. So we are, to me, our biggest challenge is our inexperience. So part of what I'm going to do with you tonight is start by an understanding of our storms. It's what I have been doing for most of my career. I've been at this for 34 years in the federal government and hope to have that many more because I really do love this job. And now I get to deal with not only what's coming out of the sky, but what happens to it when it makes its way into the rivers and streams. So I have to deal with both ends of the spectrum. But let us start by a little bit of public service. So here is what's left of Ida. Ida actually looks better inland than Henri ever did on the coast. Okay? We'll talk a little bit about what Henri was and wasn't. So this has got its eyes on making its way up toward the northeast. And if you look at the weather radar, you'll notice that we're already laying out the juice. There's a little frontal brownie that's coming through this evening that is draped from about Albany all the way back to Springfield, Missouri. And that is what's going to become the conduit for this thing to ride along. So we've got a little bit of rain coming, as we would say. So from my center's website, go to NERFC, weather.gov/NERFC for Northeast River Forecast Center. You can get all this good stuff. But you can see that my folks are forecasting, you know, anywhere from a probably a 2.5 to 4 inch rain event coming right across southern New England. If there's one thing I'll say in looking out of this with one corner of my eye, see, I'm really on vacation right now. Don't tell my boss I'm doing this, please. But I really am supposed to be on vacation. But because I got preempted by a hurricane, I couldn't let Janice down. I could not do that to her, wherever she is, I could not. But the timing of this is impeccable. My concern with this amount of rain, if we spread that over a day and a half, we'll be fine. But this thing is going to be picking up speed as it moves through. So we're liable to dump 3 or 4 inches of rain on us in probably about 12 hours, from sometime late Wednesday into Thursday midday. That I don't like to see because we are very wet. We have been wet here in the Northeast for most of New England all summer. So, you know, we kind of got off easy with Henri last week. We were on the right side of the circulation, the ocean side of the circulation. And we'll quiz you on what that all means as we go along. I'm not going to give away the story. So we've got a little bit of rain coming. We do run some ensembles in my office that kind of begin to look at what's the possibility of river flooding. And you can see a lot of the fancy colors are actually down toward New York City and New Jersey. We've got a little bit of a hint that we could get something going on in the Housatonic or in the Farmington. And that's primarily because of the intensity of the rainfall. That if we do drop 4 or 5 inches of rain in about 12 hours, we're going to end up with flooding on a couple of those rivers and streams. But here in Rhode Island, because we missed most of what Henri brought, we actually have a little bit of breathing room. So that's why we're not kind of lighting the map full of colors. So that's your government public service for you this evening, and you heard it here first. All right, so back to my mom getting and swimming out of the Shepherd's Department Store in 1954. I've kind of made it my life's mission never to ever have these headlines written in my state again. So far, so good. But the problem is, again, being 54, I haven't seen a Cat 3. I haven't lived through it. Some of you have. God bless you. And some of you probably remember it like it happened yesterday. That's how vivid one's memory is when you get hit by a major hurricane. My generation ain't got a clue. And that, to me, is our biggest challenge. So with that, I feel we have to get ourselves in the proper frame of mind to have this discussion. Now, given the amount of gray hair that I'm getting and the amount I see in the audience, and I mean that with all respect, I like to do this with a little music. So I'm related to Rudy Vallee, for those who may remember the crooner and dance band way back in the 20s, right? So my whole lineage on my grandfather's side, my dad's side, is all musical. I played clarinet since I could hold it. Now, I didn't bring the clarinet tonight. That's a little overkill. But to get us in the right frame of mind, I'd like to start this off with a little montage for you. So I just want you to sit back for a few minutes, and please enjoy the chairman of the board and my kind of warped way of getting the point home to you all. I simply call it my version of the summer wind. New England hurricanes are a unique breed. They don't look like they do in the Gulf Coast. They don't behave like they do in the Gulf Coast. And for that reason, we need to understand what these things really are. Okay. Rarely will we ever see a buzzsaw like Ida come directly at our coast. I would argue that the closest thing to a pure hurricane was Carol in 1954. The rainfall was aligned right along the axis, right along the track. Widespread wind damage, a concentric eye wall. It had all the makings of what they look like at a southern latitude. But even at that, she was beginning to undergo this metamorphosis. Our hurricanes go through what's called extratropical transition. As they leave the deep tropical moisture and the warm oceans that put them on the planet to begin with, they try to become a winter storm. Where's the heaviest corridor of snow when low pressure passes Nantucket? It's on the northwest side. Where do hurricanes in New England typically put all their rain? Northwest side. Where are the strongest winds? Out over the ocean. Where are the strongest winds in most of our hurricanes? To the right of the center. And where's that storm surge going to be the greatest? Underneath that core of wind. If nothing more tonight, I want you to walk away with those three things under your belt. When you look at a hurricane coming at our coast, landfall from westerly westward toward New York City is a very bad thing for our coastline and for our state, because it exposes us to the powerful winds on the east side. And beneath that core of wind comes the storm surge. Now, where exactly you maximize that is going to depend on how big is the circulation. Hurricane Bob, Bahama born and raised, felt the coastline. It was a small circulation back in 91. Barely 200-300 miles across. That core of wind was about 25 miles east of the center. Which is why landfall over Newport was a good thing. Well, maybe not for Newport. But it was a good thing, because it put the strongest winds over the Vineyard and over Cape Cod. It spared Narragansett Bay a huge storm surge. In Carroll, that max core of wind was about 40 miles east of the center. Landfall was near Mystic. By the way, the crow flies, that put it right over the heart of Narragansett Bay. 1938, core of wind was 60 miles east of the center. Center made landfall at Bellport, Long Island. Core of wind, right over the ocean state. These are nuances that I'm not going to fool you. We're not going to forecast that 2 days, 3 days in advance. I'm not going to try to forecast that 12 hours in advance. Why? Because by that point, you better have been the hell out of Dodge. Thank you. That's right. And don't you forget it. I didn't pay him. I really didn't. Our hurricanes tend to accelerate when they come up at us. But the trend we have seen with a warming climate is that they're not doing it quite as often as they used to. Now, I will be honest with you. Let's see, who was it? I got them all mixed up. I got two sets of twins. I used to get the kids mixed up. Now I get the hurricanes mixed up. Earlier this year, we had Elsa, right? Came right over the top of us. Weakening tropical system, but it had all the classic ingredients. Wind on the east, rain on the west. Isaiah last summer, I was jumping up and down like a kid in a candy store because that thing moved like a freight train up the coast. I'm thinking, my God, I haven't seen one do that since Gloria in 1985. So what we're going to go through tonight is a summary of these ingredients, because you really need to understand how these things behave so that you can do a better job of making the right decisions at the right time when we have something with a name coming out of the Bahamas. Okay? So these headlines are very telling, and especially this evening. But because we are here in Westerly, there's something I want to start with. So here's a little overview for you just quickly. We're going to conduct a class on hurricaneology. I call it Hurricaneology 101, New England Hurricaneology, because they are so different. So this is going to be a little part history lesson. This is going to be part behavioral lesson on how these things behave, understanding the breed, and part preparedness when we get to the end of the talk, because I do want everyone to understand what we need to be thinking when these things are approaching our coastline. But first, we are here in Watch Hill tonight, and I thought it appropriate to start with a poem. A poem that was actually written in the spring of 1938 by a young sophomore at Westerly High School by the name of Philip Green. He did this as part of his English work that he had to do for his class. And his poem reads, "One night the wind began to rise, and soon with a mighty roar, it blew up waves of monstrous size which raced in toward the shore. As each its towering summit reached, it curled like a fair girl's lock and crashed into its foamy abyss or broke on a sea-worn rock. Finally, the howling wind died down and the seething sea was still. Once more, old Neptune's rage was soothed. The sea had obeyed his will." He wrote that in May of 1938. Little did that young man know how eloquently he would describe the catastrophic events that would unfold on this very property in 1938. Our hurricanes are unique. They bring all the hazards they do elsewhere in warmer climates. But it's where these ingredients are positioned, regardless of how quickly they're moving toward us, that make them more predictable. But because of that acceleration, we often have a rapidly diminishing timeline to prepare. And that's what we need to understand when we have another system. As I like to say, anything with a name in the Bahamas. All of the coastal flooding and the wind damage, the most widespread of it is always going to be along and on that ocean or right side of where that center comes ashore. Henri was no exception. We'll talk about that. The risk for riverine flooding and catastrophic rainfall is almost always going to be along into the west or the left side of the circulation, like Irene, the catastrophic flooding in the Catskills, in the Berkshires, and the Litchfield Hills. Meanwhile, we were on the east side of the circulation, we had power going down everywhere, okay? Very classic, predictable behavior. And that should govern the decisions we make to prepare. But as I said, our systems are really unique because they're trying to become winter-like. Why are they trying to become winter-like? Because hurricanes are heat machines. And when you pull them out of the deep tropics, they start playing ball with jet streams. The jet streams that move the weather systems around our globe are driven by temperature contrast. Well, you can't get much greater temperature contrast globally than between the tropics and the pole. So our systems are able to interact. And in my research I conducted with the State University of New York some 20 years ago, we found that the jet stream was beginning to be modulated. It was beginning to be changed 4 to 5 days before that hurricane ever got to New England. Imagine that. That's when that system is just beginning to sniff the first part of the Bahama Island chain. 4 to 5 days before landfall, the heat coming off the top of that hurricane at 40, 50,000 feet up is already banging on a back door of the jet stream that's coming across the Great Lakes. That's how dynamic these processes are. And it happens quickly. That jet stream interaction is what often forces the acceleration of the hurricane toward New England. And that's what puts us in jeopardy, because we're damn Yankees at heart, aren't we? We don't move till we see the froth on the sea. But when something is moving from Hatteras to Providence in 8 hours, you'll lose your life. In Hurricane Bob, I know of people that did not move until 9 o'clock in the morning with the phone in the fire department in one ear, okay, and their suitcase in the other, because they made a stupid decision to wait it out till the morning. Bob accelerated to only 25 miles an hour. He was a little bit slower than the average. But that shows you, making one wrong decision in your planning process can have life-risking ramifications. So again, because of these interactions with the jet stream, our hurricanes end up trying to become a winter storm. Rain to the west, wind and surge to the east. Now, not all New England hurricanes are built the same, or tropical storms, I should say. A couple of things to note on this list. This is just a list of some of the top big name systems we've had over the last 70 or 80 years. But look at the acceleration, 50, 29, 35, 46. These things are flying up the coast, but they've become a little less frequent nowadays, partly because of our warming climate and warming oceans. But look at the ones that were moving the slowest, Diane, Irene. What were they responsible for? Biblical rainfall. So when we have a system moving a little bit slower than that average, the average over our period of study from 1938 to 2012, the average forward motion of our tropical systems was 33 miles an hour. That's really, really fast. That's the average. So it's when we get these systems that are moving slower, my antenna goes up, because that means somebody's going to get dumped with a lot of rainfall. The more organized the storm and the deeper in the tropics it forms, the more prolific the rainfall is going to be. There is a direct correlation. The deeper in the tropics they come from, they're bringing that atmosphere and environment with them. They kind of precondition the environment where they're moving toward. So that's why later in the season, we typically see Cape Verde-borne systems. These, like Irene, like Diane, tend to be the storms that are going to be really, really prolific at big rains. But the others, like Donna, Gloria, even Bob, you know, they were all moving close to, if not over, the mean. And they brought through a lot of wind and a lot of storm surge. So again, it's these interactions with the jet stream. My rule of thumb for the emergency managers is simple. Anything with a name that are Bahamas is our business. We have to pay attention, because we know they can be from here to here in under 48 hours. Now, unlike places like Key West, Florida, or New Orleans, where they need 2 to 4 days to evacuate hundreds of thousands of people, We're fortunate here in New England that it only takes us about 12 to 15 hours to get everybody away from the coast that really needs to evacuate. You never evacuate for the wind. You hunker down for the wind. You evacuate from water, whether it be on a river or it be from the coastline. But you've got to understand, you have to make that decision to move before the tropical storm force winds arrive. And what we preach to emergency managers is to give yourself a buffer. Have all of your evacuations completed 12 hours before the onset, because that gives us a buffer in case we're wrong with our forecast, that it gets here quicker. Rarely is our error today west or east for a New England hurricane. Most of the error in our forecast is what we call north-south. It's the speed we get wrong, because it is still a struggle for the most sophisticated computer models we have to do our job of forecasting to accurately predict that. So that's why I emphasize so much the acceleration. Anything with the name of the Bahamas, pay attention to. And it's the interaction with this deep jet stream that's going to pull this thing and rapidly accelerate it up the coastline. And again, that brings us all the ingredients. And it's this dynamic interaction that drives the rain to the west and the winds and the coastal flooding to the east. Very unlike our Gulf Coast brethren. Ida had wind and rain and surge all on the ocean east side. It's not like that up here in New England. So let's break these down a little bit. Here you have a loop of Tropical Storm Irene coming up the coast back on August 27th and 28th. Now the circulation center gets a little more diffuse because the tropical system is weakening, but look at what happens to the rainfall. It starts off being along the track, and by the time it gets up to New York City, where is all of that rain? It's on the northwest side. Remarkably, in spite of how quickly our hurricanes accelerate, these systems, nearly half of them, are capable of producing river and small stream flooding, even days after they've made landfall. So consider that. In spite of how fast they're moving, we can get, on average, 6 to 8 inches of rain with these systems. So, Henri, let's back up a week. Henri coming at westerly. Where would we have expected most of the rain to be? Along or west of that track, over Connecticut, southeast New York, maybe even as far west as New Jersey. Where'd we put it down? New Jersey, central and western Connecticut. It is a perfect science, for the most part, because that was a very well-behaved New England type of storm. Okay, just like Irene was in 2012. Big rains, but look at the blockbusters. Man, oh man, Connie and Diane, 1955. My grandmother described that as a cow pissing on a flat rock. It rained so hard for so long. Westfield, Massachusetts received, remarkably, 18.15 inches in one day. That's almost a third of their annual rainfall, okay? And that Corps of Engineers picture you see there in Putnam, Connecticut, if you've ever driven out Route 44, okay, Route 44 goes right by what used to be the Putnam Times in that building. There was a dam break, actually a series of dam failures upstream of that, that resulted in that remarkable picture. But consider that, getting nearly over one-third, almost half your annual rainfall in one 24-hour time frame. So that's the capability of what can come. And of course, Irene really brought it home, because it had been so long since this part of New England had seen, you know, a tropical storm of that magnitude. And again, it doesn't have to be a hurricane. Irene was a run-of-the-mill tropical storm with a very large wind field. And with respect to track, you know, where was all the heaviest rain? On the west side, left of track, just like we say. High winds. Let's move to the ocean side of these things. By the way, when you see print in red, there is a quiz at the end of this talk that will take you through, so you might want to take notes. But the high winds are almost always focused on the east, or what we call the right or ocean side of the storm. Here's a snapshot of Hurricane Bob coming across Newport at 2 p.m. August 19th, back in 91. Now, I was in my, 89, I was in my second year in the Weather Service full time. I started when I was at Linden State at college in 87. So I was working full-time here. My wife and I had just gotten married on August 3rd. And I got called on that weekend. It was the very end of my vacation. In May of that spring, one of my colleagues and I are in the office together, and I've got my leave slip, and I'm like, oh man, I got those four midnight shifts. They're the week of the 19th. What should I do with them? He's like, you just got married. Take the time off. We'll fill the shifts. So I put the leave slip in, and I wrote in the notes section, and I said to my colleague, Kevin, I said, we're going to get a hurricane that weekend. And I wrote that in the slip from my boss, and lo and behold, look at that. But focus on this. So the center is over Newport. Where's all the rain? West Side. 7.5 inches came down in Foster in about 6 hours. Hey, big flash floods out there in the sticks. But where's the core wind? It's out over the Vineyard, Vineyard Sound. This is why Narragansett Bay was spared a big storm surge. We blew northeast the entire event. The northeast wind was trying to flush the bay out while the pressure difference and pressure gradient was trying to bring the ocean into the bay. We ended up with about a 6 to 6.5 foot storm surge on Narragansett Bay, but it hit on the ebb tide. And without the onshore component, we weren't building the big waves we ordinarily would have seen. So we dodged a big bullet. Even Upper Buzzards Bay, where they had 9 to 9.5 feet, this kind of orientation could have brought them as much as 13 or 14 feet of surge. There are places in Upper Buzzards Bay that someday we'll see from a storm no bigger than Carroll, 24 feet of water on high tide. Okay? We'll talk more about Narragansett Bay in a minute. So again, before I skip over, keep in mind that as they accelerate, the wind field expands. And as they accelerate, we have a rule of thumb that you take the sustained wind speed of that hurricane measured by aircraft or observation, and you can add on the forward motion of that storm to get you an estimate of the gust potential on the right side. Hurricane Bob, moving north-northeast at about 25 miles an hour with sustained winds of about 100 miles an hour when it made landfall. Peak gust, 125, and that's exactly what we measured over parts of Cape Cod, Martha's Vineyard, and Nantucket. The 1938 hurricane, sustained winds of 120 to 125 miles an hour, trucking north at 60. You do the math, that gives you about 185 mile an hour potential wind gust. In Blue Hill, measured 186. The remarkable thing about 1938 was the girth. I mean, it was blowing that wind from Hartford, Connecticut to Cape Cod. We had F2 and F3 tornado damage all the way up into the mountains of New Hampshire. 16 million linear feet of usable lumber downed in New England from that storm. In Blue Hill, again, the remarkable thing to me is look at that sustained wind. Now, when you hear the Hurricane Ida, sustained wind 130 miles an hour, that's a 1 minute average. And then the gusts are instantaneous, so it's like split second gust of 160, 170. Blue Hill, 121, that was sustained for 5 continuous minutes. Now you understand why Henri, in the power loss we had with that wimp, scares the bejesus out of me. What happens to this part of the state when we get a Cat 3 moving north at 40? What's the power infrastructure going to do with that? We have the potential for such extensive power damage. And it's not a knock on the utility companies. It's a fact of the matter. We love our trees. We love our above-ground power lines. And it's not cost-effective to try to put everything on the ground. Can't do it everywhere. So this is the condition we end up with. Henri, weakening tropical storm at landfall, you folks caught what was left of the eye wall. I'm in Cumberland, 50 miles by way the crow flies, and we had branches down. You had, I mean, I was just reading, my wife just pulled up last night. Where was it where they had over 100 trees down in Hopkinton, one of the state parks? Burlingame. My God. Well, that's the difference between going through what was left of the eye wall and being on the outskirts with just some gusty winds. One of the things about our New England hurricanes that is so unique is that we have a very large difference because of the cooler ocean that's coming inland when the hurricane is approaching, that it creates a large difference between the sustained wind speed and the peak gust. If you think about that for a minute, you know, if you're blowing at 100 miles an hour and it's consistent, okay, there's a lot of pressure being exerted on structures, right? But it's constant. And unless debris pierces the envelope, blows a window, blows a door in, okay, most structures, if they've got hurricane straps, they're going to be able to withstand that. But little pieces of the roof start coming off. And you saw this on the footage last night of a building roof in New Orleans downtown. Boom, just get started on peeling and pfft, off it went. The next thing you know, the walls collapse, the windows fly out, and the whole building's a loss. But here in New England, it's a little more unique. We have more torque when our hurricanes come up because the wind gust to sustained ratio is so large. I mean, there's a lot of violent force being exerted on the tree canopy, being exerted on the power infrastructure. Because we might be sustained like we were in Irene at about 40 to 45 miles an hour, but we were getting gusts to 70 to 80 miles an hour. That's why we had such violent tree snapping and pole snapping right where the transformers are, where the weight load is greatest. So the character of the wind damage up here in New England is often very different. And this is the same thing in Carroll. Carroll sustained 90, 100, gust to 130. 1938 sustained 120, gust to 185. Those are massively large differences. And that causes the dilemma that we have here in New England with the type of structural damage. And the reason why our power loss is so extensive. And it's maximized when we're on the ocean side because our winds shift into the southeast and we are not weathered for that direction. The vegetation, the tree canopy, is weathered for northwest and northeast winds. It fails miserably in southeast winds. I will guarantee you twice the number of power outages and amount of tree damage for a 50 to 70 mile an hour wind out of the southeast than you had with Henri, where you had 50 mile an hour winds out of the northeast. Consider if Henri had made landfall over, say, Gardner's Bay in eastern Long Island. Your winds would have gone southeast at the point at which you caught the maximum wind speeds. And let me tell you, we might not even be here tonight because we saw this happen in Irene. Sustained 40 to 45, gust to 80, and what happened? We had power out for, a week and a half? From a tropical storm, no less. So these are things mentally we have to be prepared for. We have to expect that kind of long-duration power loss. And it's going to be so exacerbated if we really get a full-fledged hurricane up here. Now, the one gracious thing about these hurricanes in New England is when they are moving fast, they don't stay around very long. I call it in for breakfast, gone by dinner. And Henri kind of did that, because he was picking up a little speed when he got to the coast, and he slowed down and meandered around. But for the most part, the winds really only lasted about 12 to 15 hours. So again, kind of classic. But those who got into the eye wall here, Hopkinton, Exeter, South Kingstown, Narragansett. Power loss for days. And the winds never shifted into the southeast. Just keep that in mind. And look at the difference. When you're out of the northeast, you get some trees down. My grandmother would call him the Stunad. He's the only one who really knew the trouble he was getting into. Never, ever, 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 ever go near a down power line, period. Never, ever. Because you don't know if that's got charge in it or not. Okay, never, ever, ever do that. This is what Carol did to houses at Bonnet Shores. How did this fail? My guess is sliders or a garage door got kicked in by the winds. And as soon as that envelope was pierced, off went the sides and the roof. That was a two-story home. It's got one story left. But just like we teach kids for tornado preparedness, right? What's the safest place in your home? A room with interior walls? That would be the closets. And they are safe. Okay? Same thing here. That's what a Cat 3 looks like here. I've never seen it, and I'm 54. How do we get everybody to take it seriously? How do we get the media to not overhype it, to get everyone to respond the way we need to respond? Okay? That's the rub. We know what it's going to look like. But it's getting everyone to take the precautions, to get it all wrapped up and done 12 hours before the onset of those tropical storm force winds. And why do we do that? One, because our systems want to accelerate. We want to give you a buffer. But secondly, trust me, you don't want to be on a road with wind gusts of 50 or 60 miles an hour, because that kind of wind is bringing down branches and power lines. And that's why we saw hours before Henri even made it to the beach, you were losing power on the South Coast. Okay, smaller storm, smaller wind field, but the same ingredients. Got to be willing to bite the bullet and get it done. All right, so wind on the east side, rain on the west side. Beneath that core of wind on the east side comes the storm surge. This, for decades, has been the number one killer in hurricanes, but coming in close on its heels because of storms like Harvey in the Gulf Coast, Florence in the Carolinas. Fresh water flooding is very quickly becoming its complement because of the catastrophic rainfall. But storm surge still, to me, that's our biggest risk in this state because of the beautiful but very complex and very vulnerable coastline we have. And it's been exacerbated over the last 50 to 70 years with sea level rise and beach erosion. So to me, we've never been more vulnerable for a remarkably devastating event on our coastline than we are today because of the amount of beach retreat we've had and the vulnerability of our coastal properties. So what is storm surge? It is a rise above the normal expected tide, maximized underneath that core of wind somewhere east of the hurricane's center. That's what it is. It is created not so much by the pressure drop, but by the wind stress, which means rapid changes in wind speed in wind direction in a short distance. And that's basically what a core of wind does in a hurricane. Remember, very few of our hurricanes here in New England look like Ida, with a concentric eye wall and equally strong winds all the way around the center. Ours are getting all discombobulated. Everything is being shoved off to the east. So most of the wind is on that ocean side. But beneath that core of wind, we can get some pretty horrific storm surges. So you'll hear these terms bandied around. You'll hear storm surge, which is the rise above the expected tide. Now here in Rhode Island, we have, what, about a 4.5 foot variation between high and low tide? So getting hit on low tide is a good thing, okay? Getting hit on an astronomically high tide, that's a bad thing. 1938, equinox tide, September 21st, 1938. That's why that was so devastating. Little factoid. Which hurricane had the biggest storm surge, 1938 or Hurricane Carol in 54? Yes. Carol, Bahama hurricane, really tight eye. Really, really tight core of wind. Her angle of attack on the Rhode Island coastline, on the Connecticut coast, and the way she was moving, beginning to bend toward the north-northeast with that core of wind right over the bay, she actually produced a higher storm surge. But 38 had more flooding because 38 hit on a higher astronomical tide. Little nuances. So you'll also hear storm tide, which is the total volume of water, and now the National Hurricane Center has begun to produce maps of inundation based on their predictions of storm surge, and they're calling it the amount of water above ground level. So now instead of hearing storm surge, and you know, with the tides, you're dealing with mean low or low water, mean high water, mean sea level, whatever that means, it's very nebulous and it can get confusing. Now what we're doing is we're translating that for you and saying, hey, in Westerly, we may have water 3 to 5 feet above ground level in the lowest lying areas. So that's the way we're trying to describe for you how the storm surge is going to behave. Again, proximity is everything. Where is that core wind? And what's the angle of attack of that storm? And what is its intensity when it arrives? Hurricane Carol, 1954. Landfall near Mystic, core wind right up the bay, nearly 15 feet of surge in Providence. South coast, anywhere from, you know, 9 to 13 feet in some areas here. But it's because that core wind was maximized. And that track, north-northeast, maximized the entire coastline for us. But when you look at Bob in 1991, track over Newport, where was the core wind? Out here. We had a measly 6 foot surge. Big whoop. It's not a median tide. It's in the middle. We had a little bit of coastal flooding. We had some boats run aground. People who either didn't know what they were doing or whose mushroom moorings they realized really didn't work as designed. They wound up with boats on the coast. But we didn't see the structural damage we would have thought. Oh, we saw it in Buzzards Bay, and if you were watching that montage, you saw that one picture of what it looked like before Bob and what it looked like during. in Falmouth, Massachusetts. That's what a 6.5-foot storm surge looked like in Falmouth, and that house was down here on the south coast. So, like I said, storm surge, the big thing to remember, it's gonna be on that ocean side, but we don't want you getting hung up on a little detail of where that storm is gonna make landfall. Our emergency managers have a whole atlas, which I'm gonna show you in a minute, of how we're gonna go about evacuations. And it's driven by our knowledge and understanding of how that surge is gonna behave, depending on how that storm is coming at us. Again, greatest potential for surge is always on that ocean side of the storm. Here are a couple of different looks. This was on the Stone Bridge in Portsmouth at the upper part of the Saconic River at the height of 1938. That's about a 14-foot storm surge. That location, under the right circumstances, will see a 20-foot storm surge from a Category 3 one day. Go down to Island Park and show me a spit of land that's that high. Doesn't exist. And consider the amount of erosion that's happened. Very, very vulnerable part of our coastline. Here, Tropical Storm Irene pushed a whole lot of water in the Long Island Sound. So it doesn't even have to be a hurricane to have that kind of damage. And then when you look at Sandy in 2012, Sandy was a little bit unique, and we'll talk about here in a moment, because she was very slow moving. That ocean was coming at the state of Rhode Island from Bermuda for 3 days, hitting tide cycle after tide cycle after tide cycle. A very unusual set of circumstances for us, but it looked like a Cat 2 hurricane had hit Musquamacan. So how do we know who to evacuate, when to evacuate? The first part of this problem was solved by the Corps of Engineers working with the National Hurricane Center to run simulated hurricane tracks. Now these double lines you see here, the arrows, they are all simulated hurricane tracks. And what we do is we base the core of wind field based on the climatological average, which is about 35 miles east of the center. And then we vary the angle of attack and we vary the intensity of the hurricane. And then we run these tracks every couple of miles along the coast and we bundle up into an envelope of water what the max surge is. The Corps of Engineers translates this information into evacuation zones. That's what you need to know. But what I want to illustrate to you is how the nuances play out. For example, Fox Point Hurricane Barrier. You notice that in a Category 3 hurricane moving north-northeast at 30, worst case scenario, because we're not isolating it to one of these tracks, it's representative of the maximum volume of ocean coming at you for any of these tracks. You notice that it doesn't overtop the barrier. That hurricane barrier is built to handle about an 18-foot storm surge. Okay, that's why they built it back in the 1960s. So let's look at westerly. On this kind of track, we would expect anywhere from a 7 to 10-foot storm surge along the south coast. Now there are a couple little places here that might get up to 10.6. We go farther up the bay, you notice something. The elevations go up. The amount of surge gets higher. Why? Because you're filling the bathtub. You're pushing all that water up the bay. But what the bay doesn't get in the upper bay is the violent wind and wave action that you get on the south coast. In Sandy, we saw very little damage in the upper bay. The structural damage was confined to the south coast because of the wave battery and the large swells. You just don't get that in the upper bay. The upper bay, it's more you're floating things off foundations. Down here in the lower bay, it's both floating things and it's wind and wave combined. So, you know, this kind of gives you an idea north to south of the spread, 7 to 10 feet on the south coast and 10 to 18 feet. And this basically is representative of what Carroll pushed up here back in 1954. Let's change one little feature. Let's keep this a Category 3. Let's keep it moving at 30 miles an hour, but let's instead shift the angle of attack to due north. Now you notice you folks are a little worse off, right? Getting a little bit more surge down here, 9 to 12 feet instead of 7 to 10. In the upper bay, well, now we're pushing 16 feet up the Seekonk River. You're pushing over 12 feet up into Mount Hope Bay, 15 feet up Mount Hope Bay, going up the Taunton River. Big, big difference. Subtle shift in track. Subtle shift in track can dramatically change the way that surge behaves. Do I want you getting hung up on all that? No. I want you to know your zone. All I want you to do is know where you are if you live in a coastal flood area. Know your zone. One more little change. Let's go ahead and accelerate this thing at 60 miles an hour, like 1938. Notice the difference in numbers. Now you're getting anywhere 10 to 18 feet in parts of the lower south coast. And now you're exceeding 20 feet a couple of places, and the potential of actually overtopping some of the dikes in the levee systems up there in the upper part of Providence. Another location that would get crushed in a slightly different orientation would be New Bedford Harbor. The New Bedford Harbor hurricane barrier actually would not sustain most Category 3s moving northeast. That structure would be overtopped. The Fox Point barrier can handle a much, much larger storm, a much more intense storm. So again, that angle of attack, very, very subtle changes can result in big, big differences in how deep the water gets on the coast. But we don't want you getting hung up with that. We want you to go to the Rhode Island Emergency Management website and pull up the evacuation maps for the towns. Every single coastal community in Rhode Island has an evacuation map, and we've tried to simplify it. Break it up into two zones. Zone A is for a Cat 1 or Cat 2 storm, get out. Zone B is for a Category 3, Category 4. Yes, we run Category 4s because our ocean can actually sustain a storm of that intensity to this latitude. We've never seen it. Maybe the 1635 Pilgrim hurricane may have been a Category 4, based on what oral history we have of how high they found canoes in the trees in Upper Narragansett Bay, okay? But no one alive has ever seen a storm of that magnitude, but we map it out. Now, you might think, hey, wait a minute, you know, Dave, I might live here. My house has never been flooded. Well, there are two parts to this. Number one, maybe you haven't lived there long enough. Okay? But more likely, it's because these evacuation zones account for parts of the town that will be inaccessible to fire and rescue. So they account for areas that will be cut off because of the surge coming in, maybe from the back, or roadways being cut off because of the way the surge is evolving. So while these look like pretty large areas, realize that they are accounting for parts of the community that will be inaccessible because they want to be able to get fire and rescue, or after the event, God forbid, search and rescue in there. That's why you see the recommended areas the way they are. But go to the website. If you don't know your zone, find out. Now, Barrington is kind of my ground zero. That tannish shade, that brownish shade, is the Category 1-2. There isn't a whole lot of real estate left in Barrington because they are not only a seaside community, but they have a couple of rivers that surround them. 10 Mile, Palmer, okay? The surge goes up those rivers. In Tropical Storm Irene, my river center was forecasting a storm surge to move from the Battery at New York Harbor 151 miles up the Hudson River to Albany. And we forecasted it within 1 inch with a 12-hour lead time. We know how these things are going to behave. So we have communities. Warwick Neck is another one. Look at how much of Warwick Neck they recommend to be evacuated in that Zone B, which is a Cat 3, Category 4 storm. They do that because they are going to be completely cut off at Connecticut Point. They're going to be completely separated. They will not be able to get fire and rescue in there. So much of Warwick Neck is recommended to be evacuated, but whoever leaves? Most people figure, I'm so high up, what do I got to worry about? Well, the day we get the Cat 3 and you're knocked out like this and you're sitting underwater or surrounded by water for 12 hours, you might want to rethink your decision. But this is how important these maps are. So that's why I encourage you, go to the Rhode Island Emergency Management website. That's what these maps are there for. Know your zone. It's that simple. All right, so a little bit of walk at the beach, and then we'll wrap up with a little bit of what I want to make sure you're all doing the next time we get one of these up here. First of all, I call this urban renewal. Okay, tongue in cheek. That's what happened to Oakland Beach after Carroll. That's one of a handful of areas that they did not let them rebuild, at least right on the beach. But, I mean, you've got foundations that homes are gone. Look at how far the debris line in. Anything, this is four or five city blocks, completely destroyed. And you can go 8 to 10 blocks inland, and you've got houses that are in such damaged state that you can't live in them. You can't live in them. So that was Carroll, 1954. Think of what we've got down there now. I invite you to go to Iggy's, not promoting them, but I do like their clam cakes and chowder. Go down there and walk that beach. And look at a couple of the houses that are sitting there. There are a couple of people who have done it correctly with breakaway construction in the lower level. But most of them have not. It's a very vulnerable coastline. That's what a Category 3 looks like. And here we are, of course, in Musquamic and after Carroll in 1954. And in that foundation is somebody's Buick. That looks a little bit like what Sandy did to the South Coast. Okay? The difference is we had a whole lot more beachfront before Carroll than we do now. Much more vulnerable for this kind of storm, which is why we're so concerned. So then comes Sandy, very odd in that she pulled a hard left and came ashore in New Jersey. But what she lacked in the classic setup for New England, she made up for because she was pushing water toward the state beaches for 3 days. Most of the time our hurricanes are gonna be, like I said, in for breakfast, gone by dinner. Sandy was very unique. She didn't accelerate until the last minute. And because the circulation was so large, we had swells coming from the southeast, literally from Bermuda, for days, banging away on the dunes. In the 3 tide cycles, Sunday night, Monday morning, and then Monday night, which was the height of the event, we were eroding and eroding and eroding and weakening the dune structures to the point that when we finally caught the core of the wind, or what side of the wind field we got, hitting on a high tide after those dunes had been so beaten up. That's why we had the kind of damage we did on the South Coast. I was briefing Governor Chafee at the time, and I remember pleading with him, don't focus on the landfall being over New Jersey, because you have 1,000 miles of Atlantic Ocean that's gonna make hay with your coastline. I came this close to saying you're gonna lose tax base. Because in essence, what else do you do to try to convince the decision makers that, you know, get that concept of, oh, the track is over New Jersey out of your mind, okay? We're talking about big damage. I went down there 2 days after, and you'll see a couple of the pictures here in a moment, to validate what we were predicting, which was Category 2 inundation. And sure enough, we found it. So why was Sandy such a devastating storm on the South Coast? Partly because large circulation, slow moving, big wave field. Okay, big surge of ocean over multiple tides. We don't normally see that. So we beat the structures up, and we wound up with quite a bit of inundation. But it was localized. We didn't see it in the mid-bay, didn't see it in the upper bay. It really was a South Coast thing. But the other problem is sea level rise. And you folks know very well what that looks like, because you're living it here. There are parts of our coastline where we know from the remarkable research of people like the late John Boothroyd and Dr. Oakley, who's here tonight, we've learned from them in the hurricane business just how dramatic the beach retreat has been. Anywhere from 100 to as much as 250 feet of beach loss in areas. There's a whole lot less buffer sitting there than there used to be. Now, you can build dunes, and in normal storm situations, those are going to be perfect. They work well. But in these historic events, with the amount of beach retreat we've already had, we've never been more vulnerable. In the Upper Bay, it's been so long. You know, at least Sandy kind of reawoke the beast on the South Coastal beaches. But in the Upper Bay, forget about it. They are going to be shocked when we get a Cat 3 up there with that foot of sea level rise we've already experienced in the last century, and more to come, as we well know. So what does some of the damage look like? Well, the first thing, right, pops the wastewater systems, blows them apart. What a mess. I mean, you know, here, I guess some call these, right, coastal burritos. It's all the revetments to help build the dune systems. I mean, not only did it take the dunes away, it exposed everything that we used to build them in the first place. Remarkable, remarkable damage. These, of course, the Browning cottages. Now, I happened to walk the beaches on the Wednesday after Sandy with the help of the Rhode Island National Guard. They actually gave me 2 Humvees and 4 armed soldiers to take 3 of us down to the beach, because it was the only way we could get in there. The one thing that struck me that I will never forget was the smell of propane in the air. Because so many of those homes had propane for heating and the tanks broke loose. Oh, we saw a propane tank sitting in 4 feet of water, dancing in the middle of Atlantic Avenue. Do you think that stairway ended there before Sandy? No, that's where the dune was. Emphasis on was. It just amazed me how much scouring and how much beach loss there was in that storm. Now, one of my colleagues came out from the Ohio, one of the Ohio weather offices to be with us to help augment our staff, and I took him along for the ride. What I love about this is Mother Nature shows you exactly how high the water got. Notice where the sheetrock is ripped off. Amazing, it kept the 32-inch widescreen perfectly positioned. I find that quite comical. But as we say, what goes in one side has to come out the other, and it certainly did. That's 4 feet of beach material sitting there. That's a fence that was like chest high to me when I'm standing in the driveway without the sand. Just to show you the amount of material that got moved and the damage it did to those structures. Now, this house in Musquamic, it got all the notoriety and all the press. It was the big yellow house in the middle of the street, right? And obviously, this thing got floated off its foundation. But the one that showed why was this one. How many houses on our south coast or up the bay do not have proper anchorage to the foundation? Whether it be cement or it be rock wall. That house was lifted and rotated by ocean, by a 4 foot storm surge on an average high tide. Consider that. What does the surge prediction tell us? We're gonna see 10 to 12 feet there. The disaster that's waiting to happen in parts of our south coastal communities, as I said, we've never been more vulnerable. 38 had it all. It had the wind, it had the rain, it had the coastal flooding, it had the storm surge. All right, so let's wrap this up. What do we need to be thinking? Number one, you heard it on the news the last 2 days. They've been telling everybody in New Orleans, be prepared to be on your own for 3 days, because it's going to take the government, local and federal, that long to spin up. In spite of all of the pre-positioning of the assets, you need to be able to stand on your own for 3 days. Irene, up in Cumberland, it was 4.5 days without power. Understand, you're not going to be the only one requesting for help. The more pre-planning you do now, the less stressful this is going to be when you have to evacuate or we have a storm hit if you're inland. Are we ready to deal with long-duration power outages? Okay, this is a fact of the matter because of how we're built. But you look at Henri and I laugh. My God, we lost that much power over that much of the state. We never had a hurricane force wind gust. For most of us, what happens when we're sustained at 90 or 100? Good Lord, that's what you have to prepare for. Just remarkable. In 1954, Cal, we lost phone communications for an entire day. All right, so here's a little quiz question. Speaking of utility power, question number one. You have downed trees, and they tore the power lines off the pole at the street. They're alive and laying on your lawn. Who fixes this? You? Are you responsible, or is it the utility company? It's the utility company, okay? Correct. They are responsible for a loss at the pole. However, let's say you realize that the power box attached to your house has been ripped away from the house. That is absolutely correct. That means find yourself an electrician as soon as you can. Because you're going to be fighting with everybody else in the neighborhood who's looking for the same guy. Okay? Little subtleties that you have to keep in mind. These are things that drive you mad as a homeowner. Understanding that subtle difference. Okay? That is your responsibility. Are we ready to deal with the structural damage? The communities all have plans. And I have to say, for all the states I deal with, Rhode Island has got their stuff together. They really do understand. They have a debris removal plan. They've got the evacuation zones mapped out. They know where the shelters are going to be. They're prepared for all the contaminants, the different septic systems that could get damaged. We really do have a pretty tightly run machine at the state level that I think will be able to help the communities through this kind of impact. Do you have a family plan, right? What have I talked about? Know your zone. If you are in an evacuation zone, where are you going to go? How are you going to get there? And are you willing to leave 12 hours before those winds arrive? You have to consider that, because that could be the difference between saving your life or putting yourself in harm's way. You know, gas up the old gas grill if you're inland and you're going to lose power, because that really can be a lifesaver. They grab the steaks and the hamburgers and the chicken and the fish you might have in the freezer to at least be able to use a gas grill. But of course, if you're in a coastal evacuation area, you want to make sure you're disconnecting and shutting off all those utilities, because the last thing you want is a fire kicked off by down wires, propane, a gas leak. Make sure you share your phone numbers too. Boat owners, right, take lots of pictures, have all your insurance papers in order, and help your neighbor, okay? It's the buddy system. Know how your marina is going to operate. Know the expectations that are going to be on you as the boat owner. But when you're done securing, if you decide to secure and not pull, help your neighbors. Okay, buddy system can pay off great dividends. You don't want to lose your boat because some clown at the end of the dock decided not to do it the right way. Help your neighbors. That's how you survive these storms. So, are hurricanes unique breed? Many times they accelerate, and that acceleration, the speed of them getting up here quicker, reduces the amount of time you and I have to prepare. That is why it is so critical to understand, number one, what am I going to go through? If I'm on the east side of this thing, landfall's over Long Island, this is bad. This is wind and coastal flooding. But if this center goes over, say, Newport or points east over Cape Cod, the chances are it's going to be more of a river and heavy rainfall flash flood threat. There will be some power outages, but we're not going to see it to the degree that you will on the east side. So let me end with your final exam. Here is a hurricane. You should know him well. That was Henri. The reason why you folks lost power, you went through what was left of the eye wall. The reason why I didn't, I went through a measly feeder band. Big difference. Look at the results. So if we have another one of these things with a name coming in the Bahamas heading for New England, I ask you, which side of the storm provides the greatest threat for winds and coastal flooding? East side. Excellent. That dangerous right semicircle, as the mariners used to say. Where's the greatest threat for all that heavy rainfall and river flooding? Which side? West side. Excellent. And when must you complete all preparations and have your evacuations completed by? 12 hours before the onset of the tropical storm force winds. All right. Oh, and lastly, if you live in a flood-prone area, what must you know? Your evacuation zone. All right. You pass. All right. Some websites for you to write down if you want for reference. But I want to thank the Conservancy for giving me a chance to come out here after COVID preempted us last year and Henri preempted us last week. So thank you all very much.